consistently mentioned, from slums, from around railway stations, from bus stops, etc. Clearly, they realize that they're going to be targeting the poorer sections, the weakest communities, etc. And again, using profiling, people who look different, people who look they would fit in their own stereotypes. So a lot has been happening. Foreigners tribunals have been set up across the country. Detention centers. Every state has been asked to establish one detention center at least in every state. And I just mentioned the point about UP police circular. Okay. So finally, last 20 seconds. This entire hunt for foreigners, infiltrators, essentially it's a code for Muslims. This, to my mind, is a handy tool. In the past, for the last 2-3 years, lynchings have been a useful tool for the BJP to mobilize, to polarize societies, but also to, in a sense, to consolidate the Hindu base. Probably it has run its life, run its course, and the foreigner hunt is now, because it's just works to scale, it's ripping communities apart. It's dividing down to the district and sub-district level, where you have in procedures, you have the provision for people to make objections that this particular person, I think he or she is a foreigner. And that is a legal process, that's a part of the legal process. And I imagine that happening across the country. That's happening in Assam already. That happening across the country, in every taluka, in every district. Or that's going to do to society. So it rips, it tears a community apart. But it's actually going to be beneficial in the way BJP sees its own political mobilization. So obviously dividends. Also the fact that just using brute force to push through discriminatory laws, because all of this is based on certain laws and regulations, however discriminatory they might be. But they're using existing, or they're creating, they're enabling laws that allow them to do this. Remarkable is the fact that they can do all of this without considerations or consequences. So no check on wanton disregard for constitutionalism, rule of law. The press is compromised. There's no, we heard about Kashmir, what is happening, no judicial review. And essentially that we see, and very clearly there's a clear trend that after May 2019, when this government was elected back with a bigger majority, I think they see that as a legitimization of anything that they want to do, and therefore the enhanced ambition to do what they have. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I think that 20 second turn into 2 minutes because of the disruption earlier. Next speaker is Rajaratna Ambedkar.
Good afternoon, everyone. I will stick to the point on fascism because we have a lack of time we are running. To continue my subject, I would like to quote Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar in his book Pakistan or Partition of India. Babasaheb Ambedkar writes, "If a Hindu Raj does become a fact, it will no doubt be the greatest calamity for this country. Hindu Raj must be prevented at any cost." Ambedkar wrote in a memorandum on the rights of states and minorities dated March 24, 1947, which he submitted to the Subcommittee on Fundamental Rights. He wrote, "Unfortunately for the minorities in India, Indian nationalism has developed a new doctrine which may be called the divine right of the majority to rule the minorities according to the wishes of the majority. Any claim for the sharing of power the minority is called communalism, while the monopolizing of the whole power, the majority, is called nationalism." Being a descendant of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, I will like to stick to my point on fascism. And to prove my point, I will quote Ms. Mahua Moitra. "During the 2-day debate on the motion of thanks to the Indian President's address in the Parliament held on 24 and 25th June 2019, Mahua Moitra, the first-time member of Parliament, in her maiden speech in Parliament, took on the government led by PM Narendra Modi, point by point on a host of issues, and declared that all the signs of early fascism are visible in India today. Harish C. Menon, in his article, India is displaying classic signs that foreshadow fascism by applying the 14 features of fascism proposed by Umberto Eco, the Italian novelist and philosopher, warns that India is rapidly slipping into neo-fascism. Shaken by and concerned about the visible and dreadful changes that have taken up residence in the Indian society during Modi's term as the Prime Minister of India, host of other concerned citizens are echoing with one accord about the rising neo-fascism in India. However, are these visible and dreadful changes in the Indian society during the rule of Modi signs of rising neo-fascism? What do you mean by neo-fascism? Whenever we utter the word fascism, our memory goes back to the period between First World War and Second World War. Fascists like Benito Mussolini of Italy and Adolf Hitler of Germany, and images like dictatorship, racism, concentration camps, violence and genocide. However, the contemporary fascism is neither the reproduction of historic fascism nor something completely different. Umberto Eco in his book Earth Fascism says, "Earth fascism is still around us, sometimes in plain clothes. It would be easier for us if there appeared on the world scene somebody saying, I want to reopen Auschwitz. I want the black shirts to parade again in the Italian square." Earth fascism can come back under the most innocent of disguises. Aristotle Kallis said, "Neo-fascism represents a continual evolution of fascism with resemblances in certain ways with historic fascism and distinct features specific to the political, economy and culture of each country. In the present day world, several movements and regimes have arose deeply indebted to historic fascism but also with original features of their own. The relationship of fascism to organized religion, gender, modernity, cultural, economics, Melchiorism, totalitarianism, technology and modernism is coming into ever sharper focus. British political theorist Roger Griffin developed the idea of palingenesis. This word is a combination of two Greek words, palin, which means again, and genesis, which means birth. Palingenesis is a concept of rebirth or recreation. The term palingenesis connotes rebirth, not in the form of, not in the sense of restoration of what has been, but of a new birth of a nation which retains central eternal principles, for example, Hindu culture, Hindu virtues, Aryan, in the new society. The preamble of the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangha, which is the umbrella organization of all wings, including Bharatiya Janata Party, BJP, that promotes ultra-nationalism in India is, to eradicate the fissiparous tendencies arising from the diversities of sect, faith, caste, creed, and from the political, economic, and provincial differences among Hindus, and to bring about an all-round regeneration of the Hindu Samaj. Similarly, the RSS prayer and oath, which is administered to every entrant, enjoins him to work for the all-round greatness of Bharatvarsh by fostering the growth of my sacred Hindu religion, Hindu society, and Hindu culture. Fascism is a political ideology whose mythic core is a palingenetic ultra-nationalism, presupposes historical conditions of socio-political crisis for the mass appeal of its vision of a new birth of the nation. In May 2014, Narendra Modi has led Bharatiya Janata Party to victory on the pledge of creating a new India at a time when the country was reeling under corruption, scams, unemployment, policy paralysis, price rises of daily commodities, which resulted in anxiety, insecurity and resentment among people against the government. He pointed to the reality of continuing economic crisis, high unemployment, the deteriorating economic conditions of the working class and the weakening of the country with weak and incapable leadership. He promised economic prosperity of Gujarat model and end of crony capitalism. All of this was laced with communalism and xenophobia. Even though Narendra Modi failed to keep up his promises during his first term as the Prime Minister, with worsened economy due to his policy of currency demonetization, rising corruption and rising unemployment, he has successfully directed the ire of certain section of Indians against minority communities, particularly Muslims, scheduled caste peoples and scheduled tribe peoples, as the cause for the ills of the nation. For example, reservation provisions. In the constitution of the India for the scheduled caste people and scheduled tribes was pointed for the unemployment and inefficiency of workforce and elsewhere. Although India boasts about economic and technological development and development in a host of other areas, the general Indian mind is strongly rooted in the primitive caste system. Casteism has entered into the marrow and bones of majority of Indians, irrespective of their socio-economic and educational status. The purity pollution concept based on caste system dehumanizes the Dalits to undergo social exclusion, occupational segregation and economic and political deprivation. Honor killing, kha panchayats are normal and acceptable in Indian society. On 26th April 2019, a 21-year-old Dalit young man was allegedly beaten to death by the upper caste men for having his dinner while sitting in a chair in front of them at a wedding in Srikot, Tehri Gadwal district, Uttarakhand state. Caste system is not just a religious system, but also a socio-economic system, much worse than slavery. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, the architect of the Constitution of India, mentions six principles of caste system. One, graded inequality between different castes. Second, complete disarmament of the Shudras and the Untouchables. Third, complete ban on education of the Shudras and the Untouchables. Fourth, total exclusion of the Shudras and the Untouchables from the places of power. Fifth, prohibition of Shudras and the Untouchables acquiring property. And sixth, total subjugation and separation of women. To such a casteist Indian mindset, which tries to maintain its caste domination and caste privilege approved by the religiously sanctioned caste system, the son-in-law treatment given by the Indian constitution for Dalits through the provision of reservation in educational institutions, jobs and legislature as articulated in Article 330 of the Indian constitution is very difficult to digest. This pervasive crisis mindset against the Dalits has been encashed by Modi and ultra-nationalists by making Dalits as scapegoats for the crisis of unemployment. The rekindled hostility and siege mindset of the upper caste against the Dalit has been expressed through harassment, violence and lynching. Simultaneously, the public anxiety, insecurity and fear has been heightened through selective, sensationalized coverage of Islamic terrorist incidents by the mainstream media, and this has led to Islamophobia and to the issue of defending national security as matter of utmost priority. Regardless of any associated transgressions in the domain of human rights and freedom. Thus, Muslims, both inside and outside, are projected as a security threat. The specter of radicalization of minority of Muslims in India and outside has also affirmed ultra-nationalist anti-pluralist argument, leading to stronger accusation and propaganda that Muslim community is either unwilling or unable to integrate into an alleged national way of life. Street violence against Muslims in the form of attacks and mob lynching is normalized in India. Recently, two videos are circulated. One inciting all Hindus to enter houses of Muslims to teach them lesson against so-called love jihad, and other one threatens those who do not say Jai Shri Ram will be sent to the graveyards. So, the animosity against the Dalits and the Muslim is pervasive in the Indian society. This collective crisis mindset is present beneath the surface of Indian democracy. Moreover, caste system is anti-democracy system, and so casteism goes against the spirit and ethos of democracy. In this thriving democracy, caste politics is a norm. Democracy is seen with the caste eyes. In the evolution of new birth of nation, Dalit and Muslims have become targets for the ultra-nationalist lynch mobs, thus feeding an ultra-nationalism that is useful for oligarchy and that merges with the concern of the plutocracy. Fascism always replaces the general principle on which the theories and practices of modern democracies are based. recognition of diversity of opinions, recourse to electoral procedures to determine a majority, guarantee of the rights to minority, etc. With opposed values to the requirements of the collective discipline and the authority of the supreme leader and his main agents. This reversal of values in then accompanied by a return of backward-looking ideas which are able to provide an apparent legitimacy to the procedures of submission that are implemented. The proclamation of the past of submitting to the state religion or to some supposed characteristics of the race or the ethnic nation make up the panoply of ideological discourses deployed by the fascist powers. The complete development of a fascist state understood as a historical process requires... Yeah, only 2 minutes are left and I will try to cover all my article. The complete development of a fascist state understood as a historical process requires a seizure of the state apparatus totality. After winning the elections and taking control of the government, fascist interests have historically employed semi-legal means, brutality, propaganda and intimidation as means of integration, with the business class looking the other way or even providing direct support. In a complete fascist takeover of the state, the already incomplete protection to the individuals offered by the liberal democracy are more or less eliminated along with political opposition. On 18th July 2019, Union Home Minister Amit Shah stood in Parliament and promised to expand the National Register of Citizens to the rest of India. The contentious project currently confined to Assam attempts to make a list of all those who can prove their Indian citizenship. Shah declared that we will identify all the illegal immigrants and infiltrators living on every inch of this country, deport them as per the international law. Neo-fascism aims to bring changes in the management of various state agencies and institutions by its representatives who will openly advocate racism, communalism, nationalism, homophobia, police violence and extreme militarism. A deeply worrying fact is that the ultra-nationalists have penetrated every institutions of the Indian state, including the army, the judiciary, the state security apparatus, universities, medias, and many other in India. There has been concentrated effort by the ruling BJP to make India opposition Mukt Bharat. This has already been announced by the BJP leaders. We will win the 2019 polls, and after the 2019 victory, nobody will be able to remove us for the next 50 years, said Union Law Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad in September 2018. BJP Lok Sabha Member of Parliament from Unnao, Sakshi Maharaj, said, after the elections, there will be no election in 2024. Actually, both Ravi Shankar Prasad and Sakshi Maharaj has expressed their words, modified version of RSS master plan for India. The one nation, one culture premise of the RSS has been subtly enlarged to include one party, one leader as well. In the RSS scheme of things, the Hindu Rashtra does not need democracy. The second stage was aimed at establishing control over and integration of military, universities, medias and other social and cultural organizations. The extremization of heterogeneity within major cultural institutions is best illustrated by the absorption of universities into Nazi doctrine. They were used to promote the Nazi ideology, helping rationalizing anti-Semitism and presiding over symbolic book burning. In neo-fascism state, public education will be privatized, representing an assault on bedrock of democracy. Recently in India, Nagpur University has brought into a damaging change in their SYBA history course. The chapter Rise of Communalism in India has been replaced with History of RSS and its role in nation building. In order to bring universities in line, there are more attacks on them by the government to intimidate them. Individuals are being labeled as anti-nationals for criticizing the ruling government of India. There have been regular attacks on Jawaharlal Nehru University on ground of it being a breeding ground of anti-nationals. There is also an ongoing witch hunt of anti-national professors and professors who belong to minority community. From this point on, fascist rule was consolidated in all the main institutions of the state and the chief ideologist organ of civil society. How should we resist for neo-fascism? One should be concerned as there seems to be international cooperation and mutual support among the neo-fascist leaders. Santiago Zabala says, beyond Europe, efforts to unify Right-wing populists have spanned the globe. Former White House aide Steve Bannon, for example, dreams of creating a united cross-border front from Brazil through the United States and Europe all the way to India and Philippines against refugees, cosmopolitanism, and anyone who supports this, including Pope Francis. This demands a concerted international opposition to neo-fascism. Fascination of nation is a process, and if the nature of the fascist techniques of gaining power by means of propaganda, violence, threats, intimidation and betrayal are better understood at an early stage and by the population in general, it can be countered through a conscious movement from individual act of courage will not stop the neo-fascist wave threatening to sweep through the world. It requires a strong collective action. People need to organize in online communities, and all these gatherings we are doing at the international level. So as my time has run up, I have to stop over here. But we are challenging this Nazis government. I have given my memorandum to United States Commission on International Religious Freedom. When I was having my protest at US over there, we have given this all the conditions which are prevailing in India. So thank you for giving me time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rajaratn Ambedkar. Of course, it's very difficult task for me to ask people to stop when people are speaking of important subjects and so passionate, so important to carry on. But the reason it was possible I didn't send you please stop was because, of course, Satpal, being a good host, he said, look, you can take his time. So that's the other thank you later.
I will take your time with your permission. That was a very powerful address, difficult to follow, obviously. And I would say that with the earlier disruption, this hosting of this event has been a success already. When the opposition get irritated and have to resort to such actions, like turning the fire alarm on, it just shows that we have won the debate. I guess I've just got 10 minutes. I have curtailed myself. I've got written notes here, but I want to just touch on them. Let me just basically say open up this conversation. The caste has been mentioned, and I'll come back to caste discrimination. And just to say that caste discrimination has been recognized as a systemic violator of human rights. And Indian society has a social paradigm, cultural paradigm, which is dominated by caste. And it has been there for centuries and continues in its ugly form. So it is not a news to anybody. What might be news to people is how are we tackling this form of discrimination in the present times. Let me just go back and say something about slavery. Dr. Ambedkar wrote a lot about slavery and discrimination, etc. He says slavery does not merely mean a legalized form of subjection. It means a state of society in which some men and women are forced to accept from others the purposes which control their conduct. Reading that, it tells me that slavery is fascism because it overtakes your mind. Your human relationships with other people are not settled until it is discovered what your caste is. And we have witnessed caste discrimination spreading its tentacles to foreign lands. And so I've 2003 in the United Kingdom. So I will come back from India to the United Kingdom. In 2003, we formed an organization called Caste Watch UK to address this issue of caste discrimination spreading its tentacles into the United Kingdom. And we ran a long fought campaign, and eventually the British Parliament enacted legislation in 2010 under the Equality Act 2010, in which there is a provision, section 95A, which basically recognizes as a caste discrimination as an aspect of race. And then it mandates the Minister of the Crown to enact a legislation to make this a prohibition in law. And it was until 2013 that the Minister of the Crown was basically told by British Parliament to implement this that piece of legislation. In 2010, it was a suggestion. There was no obligation. It was left to the discretion of the relevant minister dealing with discrimination and equality. In 2013, the minister of the state was mandated, was told by Parliament to enact a piece of legislation. Now, it has been a difficult journey. Started in 2003, this is 2019, and the British government still has not implemented the provisions of that particular legislation. Why? Why has the British government not implemented that position? The reason is that there is opposition to that piece of legislation. It took a while for the anti-caste legislation lobby to discover they were caught sleeping. They thought that the caste campaigners will not be powerful enough to convince the British government to have this enact this piece of legislation. To their surprise, we managed to do it. So, once they discovered that there is this legislation that could be implemented, they formed an alliance of Hindu organizations. I will name them. And they are on record for your information. So this alliance of Hindu organizations was formed in 2013. They consist of the Hindu Forum of Britain, including the International Krishna Consciousness United Kingdom, Hindu Council UK, National Council of Hindu Temples, BAPS Swami Narayan Sanstha UK, National Hindu Students Forum, City Hindus Network, Vishwa Hindu Kendra, and also an organization in Leicester called the Dharma Seva Purva Paksha. I think I pronounced that correctly, but I'm not sure. And then we also saw an emergence of another organization led by an academic at Queen Mary University, namely Prakash Shah, formed an organization called the Anti-Caste Legislation Committee. And Prakash Shah entered into the fray. So what did these organizations do? Well, okay, they have this name of Hindu, they're all prefixed with Hindu, but they also try to bring in the Sikhs. The Sikhs represent about over 500,000 people in this country, and they're a very, very influential group. And of course, the Sikh ethos is pro-equality. The history of Sikhism and Sikh religion upholds equality. But the Hindu lobby managed to convince a vocal section of the Sikhs to support the move to stop this piece of legislation being implemented. Okay. Let me proceed a little further on this. The Hindus, they see this piece of legislation as an attack on their religion. They think that if the caste legislation is enacted, somehow their religion will be undermined. They see this attack as an attack on their religion. As far as the Sikhs are concerned, then it was a wonder why the Sikhs would get involved. When the equality legislation was enacted, there was an explanation required in terms of what is caste. and how it affects society. And in that explanation, references were made to Hindus, Sikhs, Muslims, Christians, that all of these different groups, religious groups, were affected by caste-based discrimination. And that was a reference attached in the explanatory note to the Political Act 2010. So when these Hindus and Sikhs saw that reference being made to their religion, they then obviously kicked into action. I would say, for the record, that we try to reach out to the Hindus and the Sikhs, that if that is the reason for their objection, for their opposition, we are willing to work with the government and have that particular reference removed from the legislation. But to no avail. So, well, the Hindus, the Sikhs, formed a nexus to defeat this piece of legislation. The other principal objection, led by the academics, points to the fact that this group, campaigning group, somehow is promoting, are in the hands or in the pockets of the Britishers, that we are doing the job of the British colonialists and the British imperialists. And therefore, they have come out and accused us of doing that. Indeed, they say that the campaigners, we, the campaigners, have a conversion agenda, and they see this attack on a caste as a, some form of Christian conspiracy, and they say that this caste law instills fear and impacts the Hindu people, and then they accused the Equality and Human Rights Commission, the British Parliament, government, judiciary, that they're all flawed bodies that are unfit to legislate and adjudicate on caste. There was a report published by the National Institute of Social and Economic Research. There was a report published by the Equality and Human Rights Commission, which basically said that there is a pervasive form of